My name is Terry Shepard, and I will be your guide into the world of close quarter battle. I'm a current U.S. Army Green Beret, and I have fought in two armed conflicts in the Middle East. Initially, I was trained to fight in the European theater to protect the U.S. and its Western allies from the Soviet Union during the heart of a Cold War. As a Green Beret, I had to learn an Eastern Bloc language and be prepared to infiltrate behind enemy lines to link up with, train, and fight alongside partisans to defeat the Red Army in their very own backyard. In other words, I had to be really good at guerrilla warfare. Although the Cold War is technically over, we now face a new global conflict, terrorism. To combat this threat, I've got to be an expert in the techniques of close quarter battle. Together, we'll explore how elite soldiers and police units use these specific techniques, weapons, and technologies to defeat their enemies at very close range. The term close quarter battle is used to describe scenarios that police and military face in both urban and rural environments. Although the origin of close quarter battle goes back to sword fighting and hand-to-hand combat, today it's used primarily to describe the techniques when small teams are confronting an enemy inside a building or within a compound. Stairwells, hallways, and rooms always pose dangerous and unknown variables. From basic muzzle awareness, weapons transitions, to silent team communication, all police and military units need to be as good as they can possibly be at close quarter battle. In today's episode, we're looking at the French Foreign Legion's use of close quarter battle techniques when taking control of an airport. We'll also take a look at the H&K 416 rifle system with IRNA, the Czech National Anti-Terror Unit. I'll take a look at how units like the French Foreign Legion use the ghillie suit and camouflage to hide their approach from an enemy. Throughout history, the idea of foreign nationals fighting alongside citizens in a military unit has been used by various countries and kingdoms. France created the French Foreign Legion in 1831 in an effort to rid themselves of the undesirables within its population, so they allowed people with the right qualifications from any country to try out to be a part of that elite unit. This often meant that criminals and mercenary soldiers populated the ranks. With a focus on intensive psychological training to solidify team building, men from different backgrounds received special warfare training, and the French Foreign Legion has become a formidable modern special forces unit. Most recently, they've seen action in parts of Africa and both Iraq wars, and are active in Afghanistan as of 2012. When you hear French Foreign Legion, you think tough, and that's exactly what those guys are. In 1831, they were formed because the French government did not allow foreigners to serve in its military, and this is a way to get around that. They were based in Algeria, so right away they cut their teeth in some very difficult battles dealing with locals who did not want the French to be there. I think it was in 1863 that the French Foreign Legion gained the reputation as never say surrender. They were in Mexico, and a company of them were moving to relieve a besieged city, and they were ambushed by 2,000 Mexican revolutionaries. They literally fought to almost the last man. There were only three guys left, and they were captured, and the Mexicans were so impressed with how tough and brave they were that they let them return to France with the body of their leader. That leader had a wooden hand, and that wooden hand rests in the French Foreign Legion Museum in France and is paraded every year on the day in commemoration of that battle. The Legion has served with distinction throughout the world in all times. My experience with those guys was in 1990 in the Gulf War. I got to ride in with them into Iraq, and as a young 82nd Airborne paratrooper, my first impression when I saw them was they just looked tough. They were a bit older, they looked very weathered, and they just looked very hard. The French Foreign Legion, what distinguishes them from other units, is really their esprit de corps. They go through incredibly physical and mental training, and they have to, because you're taking a unit of guys from different cultures, different languages, different backgrounds, and forming them into one team. They have their own code of honor, they have their own song. The French Foreign Legion's admission process may have changed, their missions may have changed, maybe their equipment and training has changed, but the esprit de corps for those guys is never gonna go away. Today, we're looking at how a small platoon of French Foreign Legion troops separate into different elements in order to take control of a vital airport in enemy territory. An airport can be a difficult target to approach, as it is often both heavily defended and can have elaborate electronic systems of radar and surveillance. The first element to get into place is a scout sniper team that is supported by a traditional recon group. The operators find their way to a vantage point where they can observe the airport and report real-time target activities and potentially offer fire support to the other teams. Three additional groups approach the target airport. Alpha team from the west moves in with an additional sniper. They cut through a fence line and eliminate a guard. Then put a light machine gun into a covering position on the roof of one of the hangars. Bravo team moves in from the north along an embankment. They approach three guards to the rear of the airport, and using a suppressed weapon, they eliminate one and prepare to go hot and enter the second stage of the attack. Every situation calls for a different type of approach, but when it comes to CQB, the basics are always the same: surprise, speed, and violence of action. Let's take a look at how an elite operator might take down a group of perimeter guards. In order to keep an operation silent, there are three basic options. An operator can use a knife or a suppressed weapon, but the other more basic option is that of his own hands. Here, I am showing how two guards walking a perimeter are surprised and overwhelmed. In this situation, I have to sneak into position behind the guard closest to me, and I subdue him by either knocking him out or breaking his neck. Then as he falls, I now use my primary weapon to subdue the second guard. Coming up, I show you more CQB techniques of how Special Forces operators approach and plan with Scout sniper teams. We'll also take a look at the H&K 416 rifle system. Close quarter battle is a term used to describe the training of combat in buildings, hallways, and rooms. In today's episode, we're looking at how the French Foreign Legion approaches and takes control of an airport. Thank you. There's a common myth that snipers deploy by themselves, and that's just not true. At a minimum, they work in two-man teams. Now, sniper weapons are big and heavy, and they're not very good for engaging targets close range. So the security guy, the other guy who's not shooting the sniper weapon, he's carrying a smaller weapon to support the mission. In this case, I've got a suppressed MP5. I'm also going to be taking point because I'm the one who will engage something that pops out. I need to drop it quickly, and we need to keep going. My shooter is behind me, relying on me to navigate where we're going. Being able to take a precise long-range shot in any conditions is just really, it's kind of a small part of what snipers do. We have to be good at so many other skills. Field craft, camouflage, land navigation, being able to call in close air support, communications. They have to be good at everything, because when we're out here, we are out here by ourselves. And if it gets bad, we got no one to rely on. Now, an example like this, we know that the objective is just over that rise in that valley. Before we came out here, we really tried to do our homework. We did a terrain analysis with maps, we used satellite imagery, even talked to local sources, because it's not enough to know the physical lay of this land, the physical terrain. We need to know the human terrain. Who lives out here? Are there goat herds that are gonna come by at certain times? Are there pathways that people use? We need to know that. Every piece of information is vital, because if one is left out, that could be the difference between success or failure, and unfortunately, life or death. The entire time we're moving here, we are using every bit of terrain to our advantage. Every tree stump could hide us, every gully could conceal us, and if we're not careful, a ridgeline could expose us. Now, once we're here, we pinpoint the objective. We find out exactly what it is we're looking for. In this case, it's down in that valley. Once we get eyes on, we never take them off. That just doesn't happen. So now the real work starts. I'm watching the objective. My buddy starts to dig his hide site. We call in communication. We basically get ready. It never stops here. Doesn't matter if it's raining, doesn't matter if it's snowing, doesn't matter how hungry we are, this is our job. Sniper teams operate well away from any support for long periods of time, and there really is a special relationship between the two of them. They're like brothers. They're on top of each other the whole time. You get to know everything about your sniper buddy. Now, on a two-man sniper team, the most senior guy is actually not the shooter, it's the spotter. Here's why. Once the shooter's in place, all he has to do is really pull that trigger. The spotter has the art of calling the winds. That's the most important job. Once we get here, we can use technology to get the exact range. I can pull out a laser rangefinder, and I'll know exactly how far the target is. But nothing takes the place of a really well-trained and experienced sniper calling winds. And they change constantly, especially in a place like this. You've got up and down environment, you've got stands of trees, you've got houses. The winds 20 feet from me may be totally different 300 yards from me. And a good spotter's gotta take all that into account, because if he doesn't, the shot's gonna miss. And once you take that shot, that's it. They know you're there. So that first shot has to really count. You might think actually at first that, you know, snipers have nothing to do with CQB. That's not the case at all. As a matter of fact, snipers are often CQB trained, if not having served in a CQB assault force, because when we get out here, we're working for that CQB force. We're working for the assaulters. We know what they want. We know what they need. We may have to lead them through. We may have to take a shot to start the assault. You can't separate us. When it comes to this kind of mission, snipers and assaulters are really part of the same team. When it comes to CQB, you really can't have one without the other.
The French Foreign Legion uses many different types of weapons, primarily the FAMAS bullpup assault rifle.
They also use another style of rifle for medium and long-range sharpshooter missions. The German H&K 416 and 417 are assault rifles that have excellent long-range ability while still maintaining automatic firing capacity. I'm here at the Urna training compound. Urna are the Czech National Police Force. These guys are a rapid response anti-terrorist unit that actually accomplished a lot of missions as well. Not the least of which is long-range shooting, sniping, in support of all our operations. Trust me, I've been in their trophy room. These guys are really good. They've won a lot of competitions and they know what they're doing. And they have a lot of experience, real-world experience. So, here we are. Dobře, jak se máš? And so, let's start.
This is Heckler Koch, 417.
The HK 417, yeah. Okay, yep.
This is caliber 308.
Yep.
We use this with night vision.
Yep. And you have a regular scope?
Yes. This is scope hands-hold.
Yeah, those are nice.
Effective range maybe 100 meter with night vision.
Yeah, well, you know, this is the Heckler Koch 417. This is also the same assault rifle I shot, basically.
Bullet have 16 EGs.
Okay. You've got also, I call it the brass catcher.
Yes, right?
Cartridge catcher.
We use in helicopter. It's.
Yeah, right. Do you use this quite a bit?
Often, but it's not our Maiori guns, yes.
I understand. So again, this is almost like a cross, really, between an assault rifle and a sniper rifle. This is something like we have in the U.S. called like an SPR, special purpose rifle. It kind of bridges the gap. It's got the rail systems, you can see that. Again, Harris bipod. This is cool for inside, that makes sense for the helicopter and on a metal surface, you don't want the cartridges, you'll slip on them, not a good thing. So you can see here too, and this adds some weight to the gun. This is a night vision and it's piggybacked on top of a regular scope. We have some similar systems to this. They're different, but you know, they have the same properties. This enables you to see pretty far out there. With night vision though, it can go either way. Sometimes it gets washed out by bright light, so sometimes even a regular scope is better at night if you've got ambient light that takes you down there. So, yeah, good.
Hey, nice.
Oh, dobře. Připraven.
Coming up, we analyze how the French Foreign Legion uses various teams with sniper support to coordinate the siege of an airport. Then I take a look at a sniper's ghillie suit and how being aware of your immediate surroundings is important when designing that camouflage. Close quarter battle is a term used to describe the training of combat in buildings, hallways, and rooms. Really, the primary task of any sniper or reconnaissance mission is not to get caught. There's a lot of ways to avoid getting busted. Good terrain analysis is one of them, but something else that people see in movies and on TV are ghillie suits, and they do a really good job of hiding you in any kind of terrain. Come on up, guys. I don't like having them behind me at all.
We use this camouflage when we hide before people.
Mm-hmm.
And we have another color for any nature.
Grass or desert or something like that. Now you've got something more of like an overall woodland. That's like the real tree, right? Is that the real tree camouflage pattern we have in the United States? And of course, you look like some kind of a bush in the desert. The point of all this is that there really are no straight lines in nature, and straight lines jump out at you right away. So even when these guys are sitting behind me, this isn't even an exact match of this terrain. It's not at all. But back there, their outline was broken up. If these guys were moving into a specific area, they would know by an area study or experience what would be there. So when they got to that area, they'd cut little bits of vegetation and put it in this ghillie suit so that you'd walk right up on this person and you would have no idea he was there. This suit, he was telling me, has got some anti-thermal protection in it, which is also cool because guys got thermal sights, might not pick this up. Now his buddy back there, that's a much thinner suit. You can see there's not as much to it. It's much more ventilated, so his body heat's gonna come through. The converse of this though is this is pretty warm. So to move long distances in a lot of heat is very difficult. If he takes a bunch of natural vegetation and adds it to this, wherever he is, you think he was invisible there. He is completely invisible. You'd walk right on him and never know it. So camouflage and concealment, it's a huge principle of combat in general. And with regard to CQB, it adds to the surprise because you don't know they're there. And if you don't know they're there, these guys are gonna get the jump on you.
Let's take a closer analytical look at how the siege of a strategically important building or compound actually takes place. In this case, there are four teams on foot that set up positions and close in on the target. The first team is a scout sniper team that gets eyes on the target across the runway from the tower. Alpha team moves in, concealed by the hangars, and puts an additional sniper in position. After eliminating the perimeter guards silently, Alpha team puts a light machine gunner on the roof of a hangar to offer supporting fire and eyes on the entire scenario. Bravo team moves in silently from the north and takes its first position. From here, it uses a suppressed weapon to eliminate another perimeter guard. Charlie team puts a heavy machine gunner in a support position and flanks from the northeast with an aggressive fire and maneuver formation. This cues the sniper team and the other two teams to go hot. All teams push toward the control tower where they need to disable the communication system. Here we can see how a tightly coordinated CQB platoon has to use all three rules of surprise, speed, and violence of action to overcome a large target area like an airport. Coming up, we take a look at the conclusion to our airport siege. Close quarter battle is a term used to describe the training of combat in buildings, hallways, and rooms. Today, we're looking at a Special Forces airport siege and how a larger military firefight turns into a close quarter battle. Let's take a look at how our four separate teams approach and take control of an airport. Today, we looked at scout sniper techniques when moving through rough terrain and surveying territory for future operation. We looked at the ghillie suit and how the craft of camouflage helps to support CQB. Finally, we looked at how the French Foreign Legion takes control of an airport with multiple teams using all three rules of close quarter battle: surprise, speed, and violence of action.